All right. So if you don't know me, I am Shane Ross, professor of aerospace and ocean engineering at Virginia Tech. And I just decided it would be a good idea to brush up on this. And if anybody wanted to learn as I go, then great. Plus, there is a textbook that I wrote. A lot of it was based on my PhD thesis and other papers. It's available for free, but you can download it. So that book's a great resource and you can use it. So just to kind of motivate, why do we want to study the three-body problem? And this is what gets me excited about it, is that there are natural pathways for fuel efficiency using third-body effects. So cheaper ways to the moon were something we looked at about 20 years ago. This one on the left, it's starting in GEO. And then that first pass by the moon, it got a bit of a nudge, which increased its perigee. And now we're just sort of waiting for the phasing to be right. And this orbit will naturally get captured by the moon. And it's on a large sort of loose lunar orbit. And it started out in a GEO orbit. And the only delta V was just to leave GEO. So you can get captured around the moon after just that first delta V. Here's another way to get captured on the moon if you look at the right, but this shoots out much further than the moon. And this was used, a trajectory like this was used by Edward Bell Bruno to rescue a Japanese mission called the Hiten mission in the early 90s. And this got some excitement. So what this does, it goes out much further than the moon's orbit, but using the perturbation of the sun, it gets pushed in a direction where it'll naturally get captured around the moon. And none of this makes sense in the two-body context. So you definitely need three bodies to do this. Another trajectory that was sort of exploratory early on was a zero fuel tour of Jupiter's moons. So the trajectory on the right there, if you say go from the Earth to an initial orbit, you do a burn to get into an initial orbit around Jupiter that's quite large, but it grazes the orbit of Callisto. That's the outermost icy moon of Jupiter. Then by having a flyby of Callisto and actually multiple flybys, and then flybys of Ganymede and so on, you could actually visit each of the moons of Jupiter and be on a loose orbit around it. You might be wondering, what does that mean by loose orbit? It's sort of kind of on the edge of the sphere of influence of that moon. So that one, it takes zero fuel and you get to visit each of the moons and orbit them, but it takes, I think this one takes 2 years. What's going on here? One analogy I like to think of as just the way that there are ocean currents. Early ocean explorers could visit different parts of the globe by taking advantage of known currents. We can take advantage of currents in the solar system. And this is just an artist's idea of tubes connecting Lagrange points. There's actually a lot more to it, but you could think of it as their paths going through the solar system, and we want to find them. So this is the exciting part of the three-body problem. The part that maybe people have heard of, especially because of James Webb, is the halo orbits and other interesting orbits. But there's more to it. So as part of this course, you will hopefully learn to design what are called low energy space missions using ideas from dynamical systems theory. Dynamical systems theory is just another term for nonlinear dynamics and chaos. So there are methods to find periodic solutions, quasi-periodic, and also other types of trajectories. So our motivation is new possibilities for space travel. That's what gets us all excited. The solution space of the three-body problem has a lot more to it than just the two-body problem. So there are these famous Lagrange points, equilibrium points in the co-orbiting frame, and they also have a lot of trajectories associated with them. In particular, there's this thing called tube dynamics. That's the tubes from the earlier picture. These are invariant manifold cylinders. And if the language does not make sense right now, that's okay. Hopefully later it will. There's also unstable and stable resonant orbits. So that means the test particle or the spacecraft is in some kind of resonance with the two body motion of the two massive bodies. Those are often called mean motion resonances. We'll get to the point where you can find initial conditions. That's really what our goal is find initial conditions for certain types of trajectories. You'll be able to find initial conditions for orbits with desired itineraries, meaning they will, say, visit and orbit different bodies in the sequence that you choose. And that's related to a topic called symbolic dynamics. Instead of the approach used by, say, the Voyager mission or Cassini, which is called the patched two-body approach, we can get to the point where we have enough confidence in our three-body problem trajectories that we can now patch multiple three-body trajectories. So you could decompose a four-body problem into two three-body problems. In some sense, old way of doing things, well, let's just say it's one way, is a Cassini trajectory. So this is showing Cassini's flybys of multiple different bodies. It launches in 1997, and then it does several flybys of Venus and Earth, does some maneuvers, does sort of a final Earth flyby, and then has a Jupiter flyby, picks up some speed, which takes it to a rendezvous with Saturn, and then it has to do a large burn to slow down. So it has to carry all that fuel with it and slow down. But it gets there within a reasonable amount of time. These flybys of the planets, that's called the swing-by approach to sort of change the speed of a spacecraft. We're looking at a different regime. This would be called, say, a high-energy trajectory, not low energy. The speeds are very fast. Just think of the kinetic energy as it goes past, say, the Earth that final time, or Jupiter. It's got very large kinetic energy. And we want to look at low energy because it leads to fuel savings, because you're using the dynamics from the third body. In some sense, you're working with gravity as much as possible. This is just showing ESA's Smart 1 mission. This was an early low thrust trajectory that took advantage of three body effects on its way to the moon. When you use low thrust, then at some point you're going to get into a regime where you have to include the effects of third bodies. Things like Cassini will do an impulsive burn, so high thrust. If you're doing low continuous thrust and you're going to get anywhere near another body, you're going to have to consider the three-body problem. So we want to geometrically classify all of the different ensembles of trajectories in the three-body problem. And some of these we say are fuel-efficient dynamical channels. Some other ideas of new mission architectures are a space station at the Lunar L1 Gateway Station, which could be a transportation hub, could also be used for commercial purposes, and used possibly for telescope servicing. We're all aware, hopefully, of the James Webb Space Telescope. You want some interpretation of what's going on here. We've got the Earth, and then this is the moon's orbit, and then we've got L2 over here. So we've got this coordinate system that's based at L2. L2 is about a million miles away, or 1.5 million kilometers opposite the sun. So this x-axis here is the Sun-Earth line. And a top view looking down on the ecliptic, this is what the trajectory looks like. It gets launched from Earth, and then it goes into this thing that looks like a distorted oval. If you were to see it from the side, that's this lower view, and you could see the Earth, the moon's orbit tilted at about 5 degrees with respect to the ecliptic, and then what the halo orbit that James Webb telescope gets on. Another view is this one, which is just sort of looking down the x-axis back towards the Earth. These are called halo orbits. They were named that way because at least the one that's on the L1 side, if you look at it, it looks like it was making a halo or circle around the sun, even though it wasn't orbiting the sun. It just gave the appearance. The James Webb Space Telescope is on a large Sun-Earth L2 halo orbit. And we, in the early 2000s, there was some expectation that there would be some kind of space telescope placed out there. And given that the Hubble Space Telescope needed several servicing missions, there was some thought given to, well, how would we service a telescope at the L2 point or even deploy it? So this is showing, we're sort of zooming in on the moon and the L1 point. I'll show this trajectory that's in a halo orbit around the Earth-Moon L1. Then after doing a delta V, we get pushed off of that orbit, and then we go past L2 away from the Earth. We could see the trajectory's continuation in this right-hand side video, which shows a pass by the moon, and then now this slow, long journey around the Sun-Earth L2 point. And this used, after that initial delta V, there's no fuel used to achieve this. So there is this natural connection between the L1 and L2 orbits near the moon and the L1, L2 orbits in the Sun-Earth system. So it's a fortuitous intersection of these low energy paths that later we'll be able to understand in terms of halo orbits and trajectories winding onto and off of them, which are called unstable and stable manifolds. In fact, there are a lot of possible connections in the solar system that was summarized by the NASA space architect in the early 2000s with a metro map. If you've been to any metropolitan area, you've seen a metro map. This shows the Earth connected by several connections to low Earth orbit. Maybe we got some connections to the Sun, Mercury, and Venus. From low Earth orbit, you could go to the Sun-Earth L1 or L2 for basically the same cost, or you could go to a high Earth orbit or Earth-Moon L1 and L2 because they're relatively close together in terms of energy. From there, you could get to the moon, or you could go to Mars and the asteroids and elsewhere. This was a metro map just to sort of illustrate that there are these natural connections. That multi-moon orbiter was already mentioned. This is where you could visit all of Jupiter's icy moons in one mission. And it was inspiration for what was called the Jupiter Icy Moons Orbiter, or JIMO. The trajectory design problem, at least the way that I see it, is that we have a spacecraft, or I'll just call it P for particle, that's in the gravity field of N massive bodies. The point P feels the gravity of the massive bodies, but does not affect them. Right. That's an assumption we commonly make when we're dealing with something that's small, like a spacecraft. And those N massive bodies move on prescribed orbits. So, for example, the situation shown here is kind of like the Earth is going around the Sun and the Moon is going around the Earth. Our goal is to go from some initial orbit to a final orbit. So let's just say we were on this initial large green orbit. We wanted to get to a final orbit around Earth. We want to use controls to try to get from one to the other. We could use either impulsive or low thrust. Suppose we're using impulsive controls, instantaneous changes in the spacecraft velocity. And at each time that we do a burn, say time Ti, we use a delta V of delta Vi. What we'd like to do is solve an optimal control problem. So find the maneuver times and sizes that minimize the total delta V. How are we going to do this? Well, given that this is about the three-body problem, we want to use the natural dynamics as much as possible. So lanes of fuel-free travel between destinations, if we can. And you don't start with the most difficult model, the most real-world model. You don't just jump into what's called the real ephemeris. You get a lot of insight by looking at simpler models. That's why we study the two-body problem, and then we study the three-body problem. So our approach will be, we'll study the three-body problem, and then to get something in an n-body situation, we'll use the patched body approximation. So if we consider a spacecraft P in a field of three massive bodies, and now we've got a different situation, it could be Jupiter and two of its moons, right? This could also be the Sun in the middle, and then say Venus and Earth, if we want to design trajectories between Venus and Earth. So we're going to assume that P is only affected by two massive bodies at a time, the central mass and one of the two others. In this way, we would be approximating a four-body system, the spacecraft and the three masses, as two three-body subsystems. So for example, if we were considering Jupiter and two of its moons, say Europa and Ganymede, we could look at a first portion where we're looking at the spacecraft and Jupiter and Ganymede. And this is just schematically showing families of solution arcs in that system. And then the green is a family of solution arcs in the Jupiter-Europa spacecraft system. And then we patch those two together. And this is just showing a close-up of what types of trajectories might you end up at Europa. So this was what I mean by a loosely bound orbit. this could be achieved just by finding the correct initial conditions. And if you can get a trajectory near this, then you don't have to use any delta V. The way that this happens in practice, this is showing a concept that you probably aren't familiar with, a Poincaré section. It's where you take a slice somewhere and you're looking at not just position space, but some of these directions represent velocity. And in there, this sort of twisted red curve, it's actually a closed curve and everything inside of it just came from Ganymede. And everything inside, it's hard to see that this even has an inside, but this twisted green loop has an inside and it's everything that's going to be captured by Europa under three-body dynamics. And then there's this little spot where the two intersect. So if we chose an initial condition in there and then followed it forward towards Europa, backward towards Ganymede, then we've got the solution we're seeking. That's it for the flashy stuff. And what we're going to start is introduce you to the circular restricted three-body problem, deriving the equations of motion. We'll later get into motion near the collinear equilibrium points, L1, L2, and L3, mostly L1 and L2. There's L4 and L5, and maybe we can say something about those. They're called the triangular equilibria. They're stable, and they've been the focus of interest for a long time. Recent decades have shown more interest in the L1 and L2 because they're easier to get to, and orbits around them were discovered numerically in the 60s and then started getting used by spacecraft. So the motion near these L1 and L2, there's periodic orbits, like the one that James Webb is on. It's very close to periodic. So those are called halo orbits. Those are three-dimensional. There's also ones that would be in the plane of the two massive bodies. Those are called Lyapunov orbits. Mostly they're quasi-periodic, meaning they don't quite come back to themselves, but they don't leave. And there's ways to understand what that motion would look like. There's also things called transit. Those are the trajectories that are just passing by L1 from one side to the other, and non-transit, say passing by a Lagrange point and then bouncing back. There are connections, and there's even a theorem of global orbit structure that we'll talk about, constructing orbits with prescribed itineraries, multiple gravity assists, and switching orbits. And that's for the dynamics when you aren't anywhere near L1 or L2. There are still these unstable orbits related to mean motion resonances. And some of them tend to pass somewhat by the smaller massive body. And then switching to another three-body system, that's what we mean by switching orbits, requires some care. And so that's related to trajectories in the four-body problem, where we patch two three-body trajectories. Another thing is be just a transfer trajectory to a halo orbit. You know, how do you design something that goes to a halo orbit around L2 in the Sun-Earth system? Or what about a free transfer? So using no fuel, can you really get a transfer between planets? If so, why haven't we used this? Maybe it takes a few centuries. I don't know. What about free transfers between any solar system bodies? It's possible. All right. So with that, I'm going to jump to deriving the equations of motion.
If you appreciated this video, please like and subscribe, or just wait and watch the next video in the series. There are links and other materials in the description.